Good evening, Lee. Firstly, thanks for taking time away from your busy schedule to join me today on the Inside the Women's Game podcast. It's a huge privilege to speak to you. I hope you're doing well.
Thank you, Tom. I really appreciate you having me on. It's a great opportunity, and it's been lovely to meet you over the last few days. So thank you for having me.
During these tough times in lockdown and all that, and all the restrictions that have been put in place. It's a difficult time for everybody, not just people involved in football, but everyone around the world. It's such a grueling time at the moment, isn't it?
Oh, I feel sad for people that are less fortunate than us at the minute that still get to do what we love. But even looking at family members around us and friends, like you really feel the effects for them, and just can't help but just cross my fingers that this is over sooner rather than later. I've got some good friends and family members that work really hard in their businesses, and now it's hindered, and there's only so long it can go on for before it really does get them down, and it's going to take a lot of time to recover that. So yeah, even for my nieces and nephews, they've missed out in so much school. They are 7 and 9 years old, and they've missed out on way too much school over the last 12 months. So my heart is breaking. That's what gets me. They're missing out on social skills, life skills, and important years for their development. I think the kids have been in self-isolation for different times when we were even out of lockdown. So I feel so guilty for kids. I just want it to change as soon as it can, really. But the health and safety of everyone does come first and foremost, so I do fully respect that.
So away from the pitch, you are one of the lucky few that can still go to work and you really enjoy what you do off the pitch at the Level 7 Academy. Let's just talk a bit about more of that and what you do and what Level 7 is all about.
Yeah, so level seven. So we've just went through a rebrand on the 1st of January with Molly and Rosie Kmita. I'm sure we all know who they are. So they brought a vision to our previous academy, the EDSV Academy, and their vision was to strive and become a global organisation with the foundations that we had in place already. So level seven, it very much so stands for equality. So level meaning equal playing fields for both male and female footballers, and seven representing the seven continents that we aspire to expand into over the coming years. And that is just, we aim to provide 16, 19-year-olds the opportunity to educate and play full-time football, as well as building their way up the ladder in their respective leagues, whether they're male or female. So it's definitely it's a great academy to be involved in. We've got so many good staff. I feel lucky every single day of my life that I get to surround myself by such great people. At
Well,
the top of the
I must ask, Lee, how is the injury? It must be difficult, obviously, not training with the team, going through various physio and rehabilitation sessions. Just after you come back from a knock on your left foot, you go into the game at London Lionesses, and at half time, you find out that you've got quite a bad injury there.
Yeah, been quite unfortunate the last few months. So it's doing okay. We've got better news over the past week. So I picked it up against London City in the first half. We didn't know how bad it was. I think the shock just got me through, and then later that evening we did find out that I had a fracture in my ankle. So it was a shock, but the first 48 hours was really tough. I couldn't get my head around it, couldn't understand it. But from that moment, the club gave me 48 hours to accept it, and then they rallied around me, and they've got me back into my rehab and on my diet plans. And it's just really nice still to be involved. I'm at a club where they go above and beyond, and they're on my case 24/7, no matter what the time is. They're checking in on you, make sure you're okay mentally and physically, you're doing what you need to be doing.
So in terms of the way the season has gone so far, there's plenty of positives, aren't there? Making it to the last eight, obviously in the Continental Cup, only losing out to that free kick from Natasha Flint, that fantastic goal, and obviously making progress in the league still. Just how would you summarise the season so far?
The season, it started off okay, just okay. I say that because I think I've always known what the squad's been capable of, but there was a massive transition over the summer and a lot of new players and new faces. We had new additions to the management team, but training had been fantastic. So we were very much hoping for a win sooner rather than later, and that took a lot longer than what we wished for. So we started off okay. We were disappointed within ourselves, but then again, looking at the record of Palace beforehand in the league table the year before, that we were given no right to expect more than what we were given at the start of the season. That was just our standard within ourselves. So when you look back, we done all right. We smashed Palace's league table record within the first half of the season, which is all you can ask for. So, but now the last three games, we've really started to pick up. Four games, we've really started to pick up performances. Everyone's playing the best I've seen them play, but that has just came from the training ground. We see it day in, day out at training, how well everyone's coming together, how hard people are working, how resilient we are. So it just took longer than what we wished for, but the management did tell us it was going to take until December or January to click. So, and they were right, so they're not often wrong. But now it's starting to click, and we've went from conceding a lot to conceding very minimal, but we're dry on the goals at the minute, so we've kind of switched over a little bit. So we're hoping that comes back.
As far as the Women's FA Championship gold, it's a very competitive league, isn't it, Leigh? Some great individual players in there, the likes of Leicester City's Natasha Flint, as I mentioned there, who's been in unbelievable form recently. Of course, Katie Wilkinson as well of Sheffield United. But as a whole, it's a fantastic league to play in, isn't it?
Honestly, the league, the way it's progressed over recent years, I've been really fortunate to play in it the last five or so seasons. It's just getting better and better. There used to be a time where it was only one or two teams that you knew they were going to win it. But now it doesn't matter who you're playing. Anyone is capable of beating anyone, regardless if they're full-time or not full-time. People are taking points left, right and centre off of everyone. So you just know going into a Sunday, it doesn't matter who you're playing. Anything can happen. Regardless of the situation, if they're full-time or not. So, yeah, it's a fantastic league, and it's starting to get closer to the WSL in terms of the quality in it. And it's only going to get better as the years go on. So I feel really, really lucky that I'm able to be involved in that and the growth of it.
So in terms of your story growing up, Leigh, just how did you get into football? What's your story behind it? There must be a moment where you thought, you know what, I can really play this game to a high level here.
Growing up, the initial reason I got involved in football is there's an 11 years gap between me and my brother, and I always wanted his attention. And he was always great with me, but when it came to sport, like, I was just a kid out with him back then. But then I thought if I started doing kick-ups and I could do them, he might want to play football with me. So I just remember practicing my back garden just to make him proud. And from that moment, I started loving football, when I started playing with the boys, and I got into a boys' team and I was loving it, and everyone just tell me how good I was. And because I then got so much respect at primary school, because I was different, and I was lucky enough that I was brought up in an environment at primary school where people loved me for being different. And I'm not the most intelligent human being in the world at all. So that was how I got my attention in life, was being good at sport and being good at football. So that really made me kick on to want to keep that, because I was getting attention for doing something good. And then there was a girl, Emily Thompson. She lived in my area, and I remember she had signed for Arsenal, and that was like my ultimate goal as it was. But Emily, she doesn't know this, but I always looked up to her when I was younger, and I always wanted to be like her because how talented she was, and everyone used to talk about how good she was. So when she then signed for Arsenal, that was something from a young age that I want to follow Emily's footsteps, and I've never told her.
She knows now.
Yeah. So she'll never know the impact that had on me, and I really wanted to be like Emily because she was really talented and she was fit. And yeah, that was probably when I started really taking football seriously, from just playing football in the park with my mates. And yeah, I signed for Celtic. I was about 11 or 12 years old, and I had just had fantastic coaches. I had a gentleman called Paul Brownlee, who was with me my whole youth career, and Tina Ferguson, and just the knowledge that they had and we were exposed to as female footballers that young is set us up so well for the future. And if you look at our group from Celtic back then, you've got Fiona Brown, who's currently playing in Sweden at the top level, and Scotland went to the World Cup. You've got Chloe Arthur, that's Villa at the minute. She went to the World Cup of Scotland. The talent that we had in that squad, that young, and it wasn't all natural. It was just what was installed in us for a young age. And we were with Paul and Tina for 5 years, and they really installed standards to us. We had unbelievable training sessions, and we were doing things that just girls footballers weren't exposed to that young and that early. And yeah, just really grateful for the opportunities we had at Celtic and the management we had. Really lucky.
After all, Lee, football is in the family, isn't it? Growing up as a Motherwell fan, your granddad Jimmy Welsh actually played for Airdrie in the 1950s, I'm led to believe.
Yeah, he did. So my granddad, he played professionally for Airdrie, and he also represented Scotland. So it does run the family. My dad also played as well. I think he was back in the day on trial with Derby County, but just too homesick. Wow. He couldn't cope with it. So my family, yeah, they're talented footballers. The only thing I've not been graced with is their pace. It's the one thing that I seem to have picked out. So I've not got those genes. So I dislike them for that. They were quick, and I'm the opposite to quick. So yeah, we've got a football mad family.
So growing up as a Motherwell fan, obviously your first club was Motherwell. Just how did that come about at youth level, obviously representing the team that you've supported all your life?
Really strangely, actually. The first girls team that I joined was a team called Lanarkshire, and that was like the region that I played in, and it was the only female team kind of around. And mother will actually come in and took them over, so I was just really fortunate that I got to, at that point in my time, in my life, it was the best thing in the world. Like, I used to go and watch Motherwell train, the men's team train through my summer holidays, my Easter holidays. I used to go down and stand and watch them train every day without fail. Used to get the bus from a young age, from 8-9 years old, and just watch them. So then to be able to wear the same kit as them, like, it was just a dream come true. But there did come a point where Motherwell was a grassroots club at that time, that it was the hardest decision. Even looking back, it was such a hard decision to leave my friends and my closest to kind of go and play for Celtic, which was a long journey for my dad to commit to so often as well, so young. It was a lot to commit to, because he probably didn't expect that. He didn't expect to have a daughter that had a little bit about them playing football to have to commit to driving to Glasgow day in, day out. So I feel guilty.
So as you mentioned there, during your time at Motherwell, a massive opportunity arose for you to join Scottish giants Celtic. A big step up in calibre, but you spent 3 great years at the club. Just how did you find life at Celtic? It must have been, felt like a dream in many ways, that you've obviously started at Motherwell in such a big club, a historic club in Celtic. Yeah. Just how did that feel for you?
Even now, like, it gives me shivers, but you can't explain that football club until you walk through its doors. It's an incredible football club with so much passion, and also there is two sides in Scotland, at Celtic or Rangers. If you play for one of them, you're known as a little superstar regardless, and I just felt so fortunate to be able to wear that badge and be able to go and watch the men play at weekends, because that's what we got from a young age. And I remember, because how successful we were as a younger age group, we got to go and get showcased at halftime of the games. And just hearing "You'll Never Walk Alone" in person at Celtic Park, it's just, you just can't explain it. It's incredible. And we were really fortunate that I got to play in Old Firhams at 13 years old. And believe me, it was a big deal. It was a big deal for everyone involved. And whether we had some girls that actually supported Rangers that played for the squad, but you fight like there's no tomorrow. You fight for that badge and just the passion in the club. And we got access to the stadium from 12 years old. We were running up and down the stairs at the stadium as a fitness. We had access to the gym. We had access to the Lennox Town, the brand new training ground, from 12 years old. Like, we were just, I remember, I think it was Tony Mowbray and Neil Lennon were managers at my spell there, to stay and watch us train. And just, that was just bizarre. We were females. we played football, and yeah, the club's just incredible. Love it so much.
As I mentioned, it was a big step up for you personally, and a step up that obviously you really responded to well. Obviously, you're picking up the Players' Player of the Year award at reserve level, captaining the side. That must have been a massive feeling, just talk us through that. What an accolade to pick up as well, winning Players' Player of the Year, probably the best award to win, voted by your fellow teammates.
Yeah, I think from the pre-season I went into Celtic from 12, I was given the captain's armband, and that literally stayed with me from under 13s to under 15s to under 17s to reserve level. Wow. I was really fortunate that the armband didn't come off my arm, regardless of when we were moving up age groups. But yeah, like, it's just the biggest honour you could ever have. Obviously, Players' Player of the Year is the biggest one you can get. Obviously, everyone wants to be a manager favourite, but being selected by your peers, I think it also shows you you're doing a good job as a captain. And I was always brought up to believe that Players' Player it represents how well you're doing. So me as a captain, I felt there was pressure for me to achieve that award, and I think I won it two or three times in my time there. So that just told me that I was doing an all right job as a captain. And I know I was only young, but when you're representing a badge like Celtic, it's a big deal in everything that you do. So it's just an honour. It's one probably the biggest honour yet as well, is wearing that armband for one of the biggest clubs in the world.
Also at Celtic, you picked up a nice little piece of silverware in the Scottish Youth Cup. Is that a day that you remember quite well?
Yeah, we won a lot at Celtic. We were used to winning. But the Scottish Cup, it's the biggest. I guess it's the equivalent of the FA Cup down here. It is the biggest one. And it meant a lot to the family. My dad always used to speak about the Scottish Cup being the biggest cup in Scotland. I never understood it back then. I was just like, a game's a game, Dad. Like, you need to go and win a game. But to me, it was always the league. Like, it was like, I want to win the league because that's what we worked so hard for. Yeah. And I guess cup games, to me, it comes down to a little bit of luck on the day as well. But I just remember them cup finals. There was nothing like it. Like, every family member, every friend. And I think I remember I scored the winning goal, I think, in it. And that was just incredible. So it was. And then I think the following year, we played Rangers in the final. And we won. And that just makes it even better that it's against the enemy, should I say.
So obviously after 3 great years at Celtic, you joined Arsenal. Just how did that move come about in terms of development? You must have been very impressed with joining the likes of massive clubs of Celtic and Arsenal. As you mentioned there, obviously captaining Celtic for so long. That must have been a proud moment for you, obviously, spending those 3 great years at Celtic, captaining the side, winning trophy after trophy, to then move to a massive club like Arsenal. You must have felt on cloud nine at that time, thinking, right, I'm living the dream here.
Yeah, obviously I did want to follow in Emily's footsteps after she done that. So my dad's like, when I think my dad's seen an advert online, and I didn't even know, but he kind of put my application in, and he said, like,
thanks, Dad.
Like, I've got an opportunity for you. They've asked you down to trial. And I was like, what, Dad? I'm so happy at Celtic. Like, this is my life. This is my club. Like, I never want to leave them. I've got my best friends here. And he's like, let's just go. And I was like, right, okay, well, I'm not going to get in. Like, it was probably the best female club in Europe at the time, without a doubt. And I went down and literally had a session. And after that, they were like, we want to sign you. And I remember we got an email telling us the news. And I went to walk into my dad's house, and they had a banner up in the window saying, like, that I've been accepted, Leigh to Arsenal. And it was the most incredible experience in the world. But quite quickly after that, I actually became petrified, because I was like, I'm 16, like, this is the biggest decision of my life, because all my teammates at Celtic, who also played for Scotland, they were moving to the academy. So they studied at Stirling University and trained full-time with the national team. So I knew that decision was going to be a big decision on my future, especially with the national team at that point. But I hadn't really been playing for the national team. I'd always been in the squads, but I just didn't. I was against some tough competition. I had Caroline Weir, Tim Little, probably some, in my opinion, some of the best players in Europe now. So I had that big decision to make. Do I go and focus on the national team, or do I come down and fly my wings a little bit? But it was petrifying. It was the hardest decision that I will ever make in my life, without a doubt. And took me a lot of sleepless nights. And then I remember I had a dream one night. I had a dream that I was wearing an Arsenal kit and I scored. And I woke up in the morning and I was like, let's go for it. I'm going. It took a while to settle in. Just new friends, different personalities. Scottish people are really friendly. Talk to anyone and everyone. but Londoners didn't seem to be that welcoming or friendly, and I couldn't understand it, but quite quickly I became one myself. So yeah, just great decision, learned a lot of life skills from it. Yeah, just very fortunate I've got to wear that Arsenal badge.
Yeah, when I spoke to Lily last week, she joined Arsenal, obviously, in her career, said she's played along the likes of Rachel Yankee in training and those massive names in women's football. Although it was hard to settle into life at Arsenal, that experience from playing at such a big club stood her in good stead, and I'm sure it did the same for you.
Oh, massively. I remember training with the first team. I think Steph Houghton was playing centre mid at the time. You had Jilly Flattery at the back. You had Yanks on the wing, but she was coming to the end of her career back then. I remember I was in, we were doing 11v11 at training, and I'd put a through ball through, it too much on it. But she came, I think I'd done two or three, and she came up to me at the end and she went, "Kiddo, if I was 10 years younger, you'd be my dream to play with." And she probably doesn't understand the impact that has on you at that age, that she would just be nice. But just incredible. Like it just made my day, it made my week. Like I just held on to it, and I still hold on to it at this point, that she's a superstar. The likes of her, Kelly Smith, Jane Ludlow. I was really, really fortunate at Arsenal that I got to spend my Arsenal experience with Jane Ludlow, and she was my coach then, and she became a mother figure to me. And I just wanted to become just like her, everything about her. And that's a big part of the reason that I got into coaching, was Jane and the impact that she had on me, our leadership skills, our standards, the love that she has for every individual in her squad. It was just second to none, really. Just really lucky.
So in terms of senior football, you enjoyed spells at Reading and London Bees. Just how did you find life at those two clubs?
I love Reading. It was Jane Ludlow that took me with her when she left Arsenal. It was an opportunity to, at the time it was called WSL2, which is now the Championship. It was an opportunity to try and dip my toe in the water a little bit. I think I was only 17, 18. I knew it was a big step, but he gave me an opportunity. So I was at Reading for about a season and a half, and I absolutely loved it. The girls were fantastic. I was there with Lauren Bruton, Molly Bartrip, a lot of girls that moved from Arsenal at that time and followed Jane. We had a fantastic time because I knew the club was also building to get promoted to go to the WSL. But I loved it. You had Super Fran training with you, so just put them through balls through for her, and she gets the end of it, every single one of them. So
as you mentioned there, obviously joining Reading, former Arsenal player Jane Ludlow was obviously a manager at Reading when you were there. News has come out today, obviously, that Jane has stepped down as Wales manager. Just what are your memories of working under Jane?
She's nuts. She's nuts. She's so passionate. If you've ever got the pleasure of working under Jane, just pure work rate and heart and tactically, she's so switched on. And there's very few like her in the game. Like, she is by far just head and shoulders above any other female coach that I've ever had, and that's no disrespect, that's all, I can only speak for myself, but she is fantastic. Like, she gets you going like nothing before. If you don't want to work rate, you don't want to work hard, you're not in her squad, let alone starting 11. She expects excellence. She expects you to put your body in the line, because that's what she was like as a player. Like, Jane is very much so that she didn't have the technical ability that we all have these days. So if you can implement our technical ability with the work rate she had, then the world is your oyster, really. And Jade is very much so. She manages the way she played. She's just such a great leader. And her next venture, I'm sure, will be a fantastic one. And I'd like to see her stay in England, really, and kind of work in one of the leagues, because I think we'd be really lucky to have her managing.
So following your time at London Bees, you spent 2 years at Millwall Lionesses, making 28 appearances. You must have felt really settled there, obviously picking up Player of the Year in 2017. Now, what an accolade that is. You've won many accolades in your career, but to win Player of the Year is quite a feat, isn't it?
Yeah, it's incredible. My time at Millwall was probably my most enjoyable. We went on a 15-month unbeaten run after being favourites to get relegated. And we just had a bond like no other. We had a great manager under Leigh. He came in and he changed me from being an attacking midfielder to a defensive midfielder, and I thought it was crazy. I said, Leigh, I don't tackle. And he went, just trust me. And I remember, and he threw me in there. In the first game, I got man of the match, and he changed my game completely. He recognised qualities that I had that maybe no one else had recognised, and he just changed my game. And then, obviously, I was going on a 15-month unbeaten run. Absolutely devastated for it to end through club administration. But we had the time of our lives. There was no pressure on us, but we just loved every single game. We celebrated every single win like it was the last. And yeah, it's my favourite memories from football with such a talented squad and such a good bunch of girls. Yeah, just Millwall's Millwall. It's excellent. Always have a big, big part in my heart, without a doubt.
So after Millwall, you joined Charlton Athletic. Personally, just how did you find your time at Charlton while you were there?
Charlton, they're such a fantastic club, and the foundations, the staff that they've got there, the group of girls that they had there, just incredible. Like I was so fortunate again to go into a squad that were just really brilliant people. They knew their staff. I probably just mentally had really struggled after what had happened at Millwall. I love working under Leigh. I was playing every week with my best mates, and then for me to go my own way to Charlton, I really struggled with that individually, but I still had a great time at Charlton. I just didn't perform mentally. I had the love sucked out of me, and that was my own fault. But my time at Charlton, really positive. Like, I couldn't speak of the club highly enough, and the professionalism from Ritesh to Steve Edmondson, the general manager behind the scenes, to the medical department, and then probably the best coach I've ever had is James Mars, who I met at Charlton, and he's got a future in the men's game high up. I can't believe we're so lucky to have him in the female game. He's just incredible. His attention to detail is just mind-blowing. I cannot believe he's in the female game. Anyone that gets to work under him is very, very lucky. And from that's the decision. I've obviously had a year out of the game, and as soon as the opportunity came up to go and work under James Mars again, I would just bite your hands off, really. He's incredible.
And what's been an up and down 12 to 18 months? You seem really settled at Crystal Palace, a great club with excellent facilities. You must be really looking forward to getting back fit and getting back in the mix.
Yeah, the club is just outstanding. We've got so much. I think we've got more staff than players. The staff, they just go above and beyond. Like, no matter what time it is, even tonight they had me on online doing a session, and then I'll be in Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, and then we have a call on Friday nights as a squad, and that's the staff do it off their own back. Literally from the general manager to, we've got three goalkeeping coaches. Every single person is, they're just great people, let alone how talented they are at their jobs. And we're really fortunate. We've got two S&C coaches, and one's a doctor, and it's just, yeah, the club is, it's only going in one direction, and I'm loving football. It's the most I've enjoyed it, and probably enjoyed it my whole life. Training's just fantastic, and yeah, the club's moving one way, and I just want to be involved in that.
If I could take you back to your youth days again, obviously representing Scotland at every single youth level, that must have really given you a lot of confidence growing up and developing as a player, encouragement and motivation as you progress through your career. It must have been an amazing feeling playing for your country at such a young age and representing all the age levels as well.
Yeah, there's nothing quite like it, putting on that shirt. I don't think, no matter how many times you do it, the feeling never goes away. It's the pride. You're singing the national anthem, you kind of just want to cry, like you're just bursting with pride. But there is a lot of pressure on you when you play for your country, and I didn't deal with that too well. The nerves usually got the better of me. I do really well in training, but in games, just I was too nervous. I think the whole situation got on top of me. But just being involved in the setup like that, it just taught you how to be elite, taught you what you can and can't do to get to the top level. And I was just, yeah, just stars in my eyes, really. Like, kind of when you wear that kit and you're in the airport travelling the world, it's just baffling. At 14 years old, you're standing in an airport going to Germany wearing a Scotland badge. And it's just anyone's dream, I guess, isn't it? And I've just one of the lucky few that got to experience that and travel all around the world so young.
Yeah, you mentioned a lot about your dad there. I imagine he was massively proud of you, of what you achieved at youth level, obviously playing for Scotland in every age group, playing for Celtic. It must have been a great feeling for him as much as yourself.
Yeah, my dad was my biggest fan growing up, really honest with me, but not used to give me the sandwich effect, like a positive, a negative, a positive. I just knew by the look in his face if I had played bad or not, but there was nothing better than literally having a good game and just seeing him give me the thumbs up on the sideline. Like, it made me feel on top of the world, and he would never miss a training session. He would stand there the whole training session, no matter the weather, and would never miss it. Like, all the other parents would be sitting in the porta cabin having a tea or a coffee, and my dad would be out analysing me and never push me. He let me make my own decisions. If I didn't put in extra work, that was down to me, and he never ever told me to do anything, but he was just there as a support mechanism. And yeah, he was just really proud, still is to this day, about everything that achieved at youth level. Probably gave him some of his fondest memories. I guess no one really back then expected to have a daughter that kind of went on and represented the country, and that's my dad. My dad's a diehard Scotland fan. He travels all around the world to watch the men, so I think to have his daughter wear the badge, yeah, I think he must have cried numerous times, and my dad's not a crier.
Especially at under 19 level, there were two results that must really stand out for you. Obviously, that 7-3 win over Italy and that emphatic 14-1 win over Georgia. Those two games in particular must really stand out.
Yeah, massively. Italy was a big one because we weren't expected to beat them. That was in La Manga. That was always our favourite trip of the year. And we battered them, to be fair. So it's always great. Everyone wants to beat the Italians. Of course you do. But probably my favourite one was against Wales in Macedonia, if I'm right saying, Switzerland, and actually scored my first international goal.
Wow. So
I think that's probably my personal favourite, just scoring for my country. That stand out by far for me.
Now, obviously, growing up in Scotland and playing for Motherwell and Celtic, like we mentioned, you've been in London now for about 8 years, being away from your family. That must have been a difficult transition initially, I imagine. But they're massively supportive from back home in Scotland, albeit there are miles away from you.
Yeah, I don't think there's much tougher than kind of making the decision to walk away from your loved ones, especially so young. I don't think it matters what age you are, but I was really young, and in hindsight, I can't believe that I'd done it. I actually can't believe they allowed me to do it. It was tough. I think I said it the other day in an interview. I couldn't even cook myself toast, and I made the decision to London, so I'm not much better now, but I didn't know how to wash my clothes. Just little things like phoning a doctor's appointment by yourself. I was just my mum doing everything for me. So it was petrifying. It was very daunting for a number of months. It was really, really scary. And when I was struggling at the start, I didn't have the confidence to tell my family that I was struggling. So I made the decision just to tell them that everything was great. I was doing great. I'd settled in great, and it was the opposite. Like, I did really struggle, but because I've not been an individual that has ever seen to struggle with anything in life, really, I couldn't bring it round to tell them, because they'd done what they could to support my dream, and as parents, they supported me in making it happen and allowing me to move countries. So the last thing that I ever wanted to do at them was kind of call them and say I'm not enjoying it, or I'm not doing well, or I'm not settling in. Like, I couldn't do that to them, because I know that they wouldn't sleep at night. So I had a lot from them the first few months, and then luckily enough, it started becoming a reality. But yeah, it was tough. It's still tough to this day, that now I've got nieces and nephews. So that's probably that's my biggest pain, that I'm missing them growing up, and they mean the absolute world to me. But they never understand why I come and go within days, and I'm only there twice a year, so they don't get it yet. They're too young, but it breaks my heart. Every time I go home, it's like, I just want to stay here. I have to come back down and do what I'm down here for. But yeah.
So despite only being 24, you've played a lot of football, Leigh. Obviously, you played with some great players during your career. You must be impressed with Fran Kirby's red-hot form recently. Obviously, scoring 4 goals the weekend prior and then scoring the winner against Manchester United in the table-topping WSL clash. So, just what have you made of Fran's progress this year? You mustn't be surprised because she's a top player, isn't she?
I'm not surprised. The thing with Fran is she is the loveliest girl in football, probably in life. You won't meet a nicer girl in the game, without a doubt. And she'd been through her battles, and I've just got, every time I see her doing well, it just makes my heart warm, because she keeps getting knocked back and then knocked back down and getting herself back up. And it just shows you the sheer resilience from her to be able to go through what she went through from a young age, with the constant battles and constant big injuries and random illnesses thrown at her. And every time she comes back better than ever. So I've just got so much respect for Fran as a human being, first and foremost. And then when I see her in the form that she's in, I don't think anyone deserves it more. And Fran, I know Fran really well, and she just deserves every bit of success that she gets and more. So I just hope that she has a clear spell at it for a couple of seasons, and she gets to go and really get the recognition that Fran really deserves, because when she gets her illnesses and injuries, they seem to be like longer term ones, so people kind of quickly forget, and then she comes back and proves everyone wrong again, better than ever. So I just really hope that if there's one person in the game that really deserves the world, it's that girl. She's incredible, but she's an even better person, and that's what makes her so special, and I'm just really fortunate to see that side of her. So yeah, she's brilliant, and I love seeing her on the score sheet. It doesn't surprise me that she scored with her left foot, right foot and header in one game. 4 goals, it's just, yeah, I've only got to laugh and shake my head because it doesn't surprise me.
You mentioned Fran obviously overcoming so many obstacles. Does that give you inspiration? Obviously, coming back from injury now, you must have had ups and downs in your career. Does that inspire you to come back fighting when you suffer from those lows? It's all about working hard and getting back up there, isn't it?
Yeah, like I guess the injury I've got, yeah, I've broke my ankle, but injuries like what Fran and stuff's had, they've been quite complex. So mine's a walk in the park in hindsight, and I just need to bring myself back to life. Like, there is a global pandemic coming on, going on at the minute, and the fact that I'm still able to wear this football kit and go to my football club, like, I'm just nothing but grateful. Would I love to be in the pitch, of course, but there's bigger things going on in the world, so I'm just so grateful that I've still got a few years ahead of me to play football. So, if Fran can get through what she can get through, she's nothing but an inspiration to myself and younger girls, and the other girls in the game that have had a tough career so far. But I'm just inspired a lot by those around me, and what they come through on a day-to-day basis, and probably more than ever at the minute with what everyone's going through. I can't moan about anything. I've got a boot on, the break will heal. I just need to support the girls now, and now I'll be back in the pitch as soon as I can.
In terms of girls that you've played alongside, you've made some great friends along the way, but that's what football is all about, isn't it? Obviously, building relationships, creating memories. Actually, one of my followers, a girl you mentioned earlier on, Molly Bartrip, who's still at Reading now, played with you there. You two were quite close at Reading, I believe.
Yeah, we stayed together at Arsenal. We shared a house for 2 years. So, and then when we went to Reading, Molly was driving before me, so she was my taxi. So we've been on holidays together. So I know Molly really well, and she's a lovely girl, and she's a great player as well. So yeah, she's a great individual. And she's going to keep doing well in her career, and it shows you how loyal that she'd been wanting to Arsenal. She was there for years and years and years, and then it was a big decision for her to move to Reading, and I remember how difficult it was for her, but it was definitely the correct career choice for her to go and get senior women's football, and it just shows you it was completely the right decision, and she's doing fantastic, and she's been there for must be 5-6 years now, 7 years maybe. So I'm really happy for her. Same with Lauren Bruton as well. They had quite a similar career pathway. So I'm really happy for them both. And just loyalty is very rare these days. So anyone that stays at a club for a long period of time, I think it's fantastic. And I love to see it.
Yeah, Lauren obviously scored against Arsenal at the weekend for Reading in that 1-1 draw. Final say on Crystal Palace, Lee. You're surrounded by positive people at the club. You mentioned all those people in the backroom staff and people that might not get recognised by the general public. Is it just a case now we're finishing the season strongly and pushing on next season?
No, for us, it's literally every single game is an opportunity for us to get more respect, improve every single game that we take, every single game, like 3 points is a must. So for us, pick up as many points as possible. We're not safe yet. We're only a few points off bottom, but we're also only 3 points off sitting fifth place. So for us, like, of course we're aiming for that fifth place, but we're not delusional at all, but we'll certainly give it our best shot to see how far up the table we can finish, to then build on that come pre-season. And it's certainly over the next 6 months to three seasons, it's going to be dramatic, the turnaround at Crystal Palace, and it's definitely going to become a big club in female football, because I'm fortunate that I get to see the people that's involved in the football club. And as long as they're involved in the football club and wearing such a big badge, the club will slowly take some big, big steps. And yeah, so for us, it's just about getting more respect. I'm sure there'll be a lot of players that want to come and be part of the project that we've got going on come summer. So that's already a massive turnaround, and I know that will be the case, because it's a club that I love to be involved in, and I know a lot of people do, speaking to them. So yeah.
So Leigh, I must say it's been an absolute delight speaking to you today. I'll obviously be looking out for your progress in the future. I wish you all the best in your recovery, and I'm adamant that we'll see you back on the pitch fighting it sooner rather than later.
No, it's been a pleasure. Thank you so much for taking your time out your evening to come on with me. Really loved it.
Thank you very much. We'll have to have you on, obviously, in the future, perhaps next season. And I wish you all the best in your recovery, and keep in touch with us.
No, thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you.